It's time for Twig This Week in Google, our pre-Thanksgiving edition. No, we're not going to pardon a turkey. We might talk about some turkeys, including Facebook's dark posts. Jeff Jarvis is here, Stacey Higginbotham, and a lot more. Stay tuned. This Week in Google is next.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twig.
Bandwidth for This Week in Google is provided by Cachefly, CacheFly.com. This is Twig, This Week in Google, episode 380, recorded Wednesday, November 23rd, 2016. Cauliflower sex tape. This Week in Google is brought to you by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. Rocket Mortgage brings the mortgage process into the 21st century with a fast, easy, and completely online process. Check out Rocket Mortgage today at quickenloans.com/twig. It's time for Twig This Week in Google, the show where we talk about the latest news, not just from Google, but we talk about news, we talk about Facebook, we talk about Twitter, we talk about social media. Thank goodness we have a Stacey Higginbotham here. We talk about Internet of Things as well. Stacey is from the IoT podcast. You may remember her from GigaOhm. She's still Giga Stacey on the Twitter, and she's in Houston, Texas for Thanksgiving. Hi, Stacey.
Hello.
You are there for Thanksgiving, I take it.
I am. I'm visiting my family. This used to be my childhood bedroom.
Oh, you're in your old bedroom?
It's not a bedroom. It's now my dad's office. But yeah. Yes.
How long?
Where are the Justin Bieber posters? You know?
Okay, I was New Kids on the Block, man.
Ooh, okay, neat. Sorry. Yes.
So here's the question: how long after you went to college did they convert that bedroom? Like one minute?
So before I left, my mom was bringing in stuff to store under there, and I was like, "Mom, what are you doing?" And she's like, "Stacey, don't be silly. You're not coming back after college." And I was like, "Fair enough."
My son did exactly the same thing. He said, "What, you can't?"
I was like, all the Christmas wreaths were going in under my bed. Yeah, I'm like, I'm using that.
Yeah.
But I wasn't.
Well, it's nice to see that your bedroom is still there for you to use for podcasting. That's nice.
Exactly. Yes. It's my new studio.
Yes. Also with us from his home as he prepares for American Thanksgiving, Jeff Jarvis from BuzzMachine.com, professor of journalism at CUNY. And new Pixel owner, and now I see you just got a box that says something like Daydream on it.
There it is.
Jason Howell got his a couple of days ago. We've been playing with it. It's pretty cool. A little better than cardboard because you get this the little remote doohickey. Yeah, the controller. But I am still unconvinced of the long-term value of... you got it out. Do you like that fiber, this material?
Yeah, it kind of feels like a... Actually, I want to make underwear out of this.
Yeah, it's exactly what it is.
Yeah, is it jersey? Cotton jersey?
No, it's not cotton. It's a nylon sport fabric. Yeah, so it's used for, like Under Armour kind of stuff.
Wicking.
And it wicks. It has a removable faceplate, so you can wash that, which is nice because it might get kind of sweaty.
And makeup-y.
It also works not just with the Pixel, but Motorola has now announced it's going to work with some of their phones, which is good. And eventually, you have to take... Okay, don't tell him. He's like the mini Pearl of VR headsets. You got to take the paper thing out there.
Okay.
Yeah. He left the price tag in.
Mini Pearl. Do you know who Mini Pearl is, Stacey? I'll bet you don't.
I'm an older lady.
We just learned that Jeff and I are Stacy's parents' age, which is very...
It pops up. It goes...
Well, you don't have a phone in it yet, do you?
Was that it? Okay. Give me something new and I'll complain about it. Okay, how do I do this?
Put your Pixel in there. It should sense it. By the way, what we learned on the new screensavers is that you can Chromecast from your Pixel before you put it in.
Oh, it's worse. No, it won't stay up.
You may have to adjust the headband. It doesn't have an over-the-top headband. It's just around the back, in fact, Jason was complaining about the same thing, that the headband's a little high.
Yeah, it flips up.
Yeah. I'm sure you can adjust it and get it.
No,
but you're still wearing your glasses. That's good, right?
Yeah,
that's
you can wear glasses with it, which is good because it doesn't have any adjustment for focus. which some of the others do, so that you can, for instance, I wear glasses, and if I'm not wearing my contacts, I don't want to wear the glasses underneath the visor. So I take them off and adjust the focus, and that usually is adequate. But you can't do that with this one, so you're going to either have to wear your glasses or wear contacts. But yeah, it seems to fit over glasses pretty well. Jeff, it's okay. Don't worry about it. Better lenses than cardboard. Cardboard has very cheap lenses, obviously. It has to. It's a cheap device. This is $79. And I think maybe there'll be a Black Friday. Maybe we should call it Dark Friday. A Dark Friday.
I was amazed in Germany, where I just was this morning, the newspaper had circulars for Black Friday. They don't have Thanksgiving there.
Right. But you know, commerce knows no bounds, no geographic.
This just does not work at all.
What's going on?
It's too loose.
It's popping up down here. See, it's not a snug fit. The strap is too high on it, so it's not actually it's causing it to leak, cantilever up.
Yeah, that's not good. Maybe maybe I don't know.
There's no
press your face against your desk.
Maybe my nose is too big.
So did you read the review, Stacy, of the June oven? I think it was Fast Company had it.
Yes. Oh my gosh. He had the worst time.
He hated it.
He hated it. Although, okay. One, he had a very different experience. He had some errors. But two, it felt like he just did not, I mean, like, it felt like he left it in the oven and he didn't understand how to review things because he was complaining about, like, too many notifications. But, like, when I set mine up, I turned a lot of the notifications off. So I was, like, kind of like, is that fair? I don't know. And then he also was upset because it didn't look done and he cooked it longer and then he forgot about it or something. I felt like...
He put the salmon steak in there.
Yeah.
And it said it's going to be done in... 15 minutes or 10 minutes. And then it turned out taking 40 minutes. And at one point it says it's going to take 4 hours. It was all over the place.
I feel like he had a glitchy oven, but I don't know. I mean, it is.
Well, I'm a little worried myself because I did order one and you had a very good experience with it and reviewed it in PC Magazine. I think fairly positively, right?
Yeah, I did say so at one point in time, I had a problem connecting my app to my device to the oven, but I just rebooted it and it connected then. And then I had one time when the oven, before I had done anything to it, didn't turn on. And then, so I just rebooted it and that didn't feel like anything. I didn't have any of the issues this guy described. I mean, he had all kinds
and
of
we problems. Should mention that I'm sure all of these are pre-production because I ordered it like a normal person. And I haven't received it yet. So
this is not their beta or it is their beta. They had like 50 alpha early ovens out there, but this was not one of those.
I'm trying to find this review. Was it Fast Company or was it somewhere
else?
There
was one in Fast Company and then USA Today didn't really love it either. And I knew Time thought it was neat, but too expensive.
Well, and so everybody says that. I mean, it's $1,500 for a...
Yes, it is. My ovens cost $1,500, but they are full-sized, self-cleaning, stainless steel ovens, so...
Right.
But very different.
Yeah, I mean, that's an awful lot of... I mean, ridiculous amount of money to pay. It also is designed by a team that includes the guy who did the camera hardware for the iPhone, and in fact has a camera in it. It has carbon fiber heating elements, and it works with your smartphone. It has cameras because it identifies the food. And part of the promise of it isn't really realized until down the road. It's going to learn, right? So it will recognize food better and better over time. I can't find this review. It was so funny.
Oh, the Fastco review?
Was it in Fastco? I can't.
It was in Fastco. Yeah, there were some great like one-liners in there.
Yeah, it was. And sometimes, you know, you read a review like that and you think the guy's more interested in getting off bon mot than he is in really, you know, whether it's a good product or not. But it gave me pause. I almost canceled my order. I guess I have time to do that.
They just called it June Intelligent Oven.
Okay.
Oh, wait, no, is that?
That's CNET. Oh, well. I would like to find this review, but I can't. Anyway,
oh, wait,
so
here it is. Here it is. Oh wait, sorry.
I should have prepared this one better. I just thought of it. That's it.
No.
That's everything okay. That's wrong with Silicon yes. Valley design. If you just search for that, very funny review. And everything that's wrong. Let me get the quotes here, because I think the quotes are hysterical. It's Fast Company Design. Is that the same as Fast Company? Fast Company Design, or is it some? Maybe it's a design, because then I would understand Mark Wilson writing here. He has images of his salmon. Cooking will finish in 1 minute. Cooking complete. Notification ETA pessimistic. That's apparently a error message. Notification ETA optimistic. Another error message. Notification ETA pessimistic. Please flip your food. Salmon had become more distracting to babysit than if I just cooked it on my own. It became a metaphor for Silicon Valley itself. Automated yet distracting, boastful yet mediocre, confident yet wrong. Most of all, the June is a product built less for you, the user, and more for its own ever-impending perfection as a platform. When you cook salmon wrong, you learn about cooking it right. When the June cooks salmon wrong, its findings are uploaded, aggregated, and averaged into a June database that you hope will allow all June ovens to get it right the next time. Good thing firmware updates are installed automatically. even if you don't quite agree with him, it's a pretty funny review. But you disagree. You think it's useful and you didn't have the same problems.
I did not have his problems. And it says that he apparently missed some stuff. Like, I will say, and I'm pretty sure I said this, it does adjust the cooking time. So, like, when I was making a pork tenderloin, I was like, la, 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 I have 40 minutes. And then I looked over and it was like, oh, just kidding. You have much less time than you thought.
That makes it kind of hard to plan a meal.
Yeah, if it's so smart, why doesn't it know that going in?
Well, so what happened in that case is it's got the weight sensors in the bottom, and it thought that
blows me away too.
The vegetables were with the pork, so I think it thought it was all pork, and then as it cooked, it realized, oh, this pork is cooking way faster than I thought it would based on its weight. So then it adjusted.
He also gives you, I kind of like this, but it's a time lapse of your food cooking. He says, like one of those Pillsbury cookie commercials. Unfortunately, the playback looks something more like my roasted cauliflower's sex tape. The unappetizing green glow that made me wonder, why would anybody bother to film this?
That was awesome.
The coup de grace of all the info overload absurdity is a line graph which compares oven temperature to item temperature. In case you weren't sure why your salmon took 45 minutes, here you go. It's science. And here's a picture of the cauliflower, and which is really disgusting looking. And there's the line graph. you know what? I'm still going to get one. And I'm because I trust you, Stacy.
I think you'll like it.
Not
I really
that
do.
Guy. What are you doing? Did you fix it, Jeff? It looks like you fixed it.
I think so. Adjust the headset until the image is clear.
Yeah.
Well, I can't do that because it won't stay on.
Oh, just, you know. We'll save
it. So Jeff is complaining again. Now I can't.
VR is highly over. VR, in my opinion, is highly overrated.
It is.
How do you feel about AR?
I'm very excited. I think that's the future, the real future.
Well, now I can't. Well, it's a solid, steady state image. I can't. Won't move.
I should send June the June oven to Jeff.
That's true. That would be a way more accurate.
I'll burn down the house. When my wife was pregnant and on bed rest, I never cooked. I almost killed her with raw chicken.
Toxic fumes. I can only imagine when they finally tie the Daydream to the June oven and you'll get 360-degree realistic views of your food while it cooks, as if you're in the oven with it. That's the future.
It'll star in your cauliflower sex tape.
Okay, that's enough, Jeff. Just wear it like that. That's very fetching. He's got it on his forehead now.
I'll stop.
Yeah. Yeah, you'll play with it. We'll talk again next week.
Those people who wear their glasses on their forehead, I can never do that, right?
Right.
This is my version of it.
Now you can.
That's a very bro thing to do, I think.
The worst, no, the more bro thing is to, and I really don't understand this, wear it backwards so that the glasses are behind your head and that, like that. Have you seen people do that?
It only works with really cool sunglasses. I've
been to
I think.
Festivals.
Do not like that. Do not like.
So I started watching, what's it called? I Love Bill from Amazon.
Haven't seen, seen that.
I Love Dick.
Oh.
I Love
Kevin Bacon.
I Love Dick.
No.
Runs.
Is
it's
it,
hilarious.
Is it I Love? Oh, I Love Dick. Yeah, now I Love Bill.
I Love Dick. Dick for Bill. Jesus.
You got to be careful saying what I Love Dick. I did see this. I did see this, and I wasn't sure if I would like it. It's apparently adapted from the lauded feminist novel of the same name. It takes place in Marfa, Texas. It's good, huh?
I watched the first episode on the plane. It's very good. Is there a real Marfa, Texas?
There is a real Marfa, Texas. Oh, it's famous. They do all these writing workshops. They have a lot of actual art.
So it's based on that.
What university is in Marfa?
There is no university. It's just two.
It's pretending it's a college town?
No, it's very small. It's at the base of the Guadalupe Mountains. It's in the middle of nowhere. It's hard to get to, but it's very famous among the literati and artistic set.
So why is it that at least two now highly praised TV shows, one from HBO, one from Amazon, are about divorce and failing marriages? Is this something we're going to see more of? Is this the
That's
new
why
thing?
We need a cultural revolution, sir.
Yeah, maybe.
Bring back the American family.
Maybe.
Weren't there other sitcoms about people? I mean, like, isn't Modern Family, aren't they divorced?
No.
Am I thinking of
Well, they are, but it's not about the divorce. It's post divorce. Each is remarried. No, is that right?
Modern
no, that's
family,
her father.
Though.
No, no, that Modern her Family. Her father is remarried to the Cha-Cha. Not Eve Longoria. Who's she? You know who I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah. What about Who's the Boss? That was back in the 80s, and she was divorced.
She was a single mom.
Oh, but she wasn't divorced.
What these shows Brown. Are about. No, no, these shows are about the actual process, as horrible as it is, of falling apart as a couple. I mean, of course, we've had divorced and single parents before, but what they have never focused on is the painful process of a dissolution of a marriage. Actually, Woody Allen, Scenes from a Marriage, or is that Ingmar Bergman? I can never remember. Maybe it's Bergman.
I think that's Ingmar Bergman.
It's Bergman. Woody Allen did Interiors, which was his version of Ingmar Bergman.
Yes.
Yes. Scenes from a Marriage. That's the only other example I could think of. Sofia Vergara. War of the Roses. Okay, you're right. War of the Roses. Never mind. I've spotted a cultural
that wasn't
trend.
A sitcom.
Well, that's true. It wasn't. And there was that Dustin Hoffman movie. Where they're fighting over the kid.
There's My Blue Valentine, but that was a movie.
Yeah, those are all movies. But movies we've had about divorce for years and years and years.
Yeah.
TV shows. I don't know.
Slow-mo said when he was a kid, he used to watch Divorce Court. I remember that.
Oh, yeah.
That was like Judge Judy with divorce. Oh, man, this show has not started well. Let's start this over again. Can
so
we?
There's something. What was I going to talk about here? Besides the Facebook stuff, which we got lots of.
You and a guy from BetaWorks wrote a piece for Medium that has been picked up widely.
Very widely.
Borthwick.
Yeah, John Borthwick. From BetaWorks. John reached out to me. I mean, I've been writing about the fake news stuff and reached out to me and said, let's be practical. So we went and sat for 2 hours and came up with 15 suggestions of what to do about it and put it out.
Similar to what we had talked about last week.
That's why I was asking, because I was in the middle of writing it last week. So I got it written, I think, by the next morning. We put it out and got picked up a lot. And then Zuck, after kind of changing his mind, did write a post, as we all saw, with about six of the 15 suggestions that we had in parallel, which is good. And I put on a comment on Zuck's post saying, you know, I'm glad you're doing this. And by the way, here's what Borthwick and I wrote. And Zuck liked the comment.
So. Nice. So what did you propose? Basically what you had talked about on this show, which was not censoring fake
right.
news, but giving people more information, some signals as they read it so that they could go deeper.
Exactly. As I remember, you poo-pooed half of them last week, but that was kind of the mood you were in.
No, I'm still in that mood. I think blaming Facebook for this is reductionist.
Oh, I agree. I absolutely agree. But Can we improve the quality of discourse on the social platforms? Yes. Is there some large proportion of people who would prefer not to pass on lies?
That's a question. That's a legit question.
I have to believe that's
well, and giving them the opportunity and the more information. And I agreed with you at the end of the conversation.
That's all.
That giving them more giving everybody more information about the post they're about to share is not a bad thing.
Yeah. So there's 15 suggestions.
You're taking all the fun out of it, though.
Yeah.
Because I think I really think a lot of this stuff is shared not for its veracity, but more because it's emotionally true and it feels true. And this is how I feel right now, and I'd like to share this. And it strikes me that that's really what social media is for you to share your feelings. And I think it's intrusive to ask a social media network to, somehow say, well, your feelings are not okay. Well, I don't agree with your feelings.
When those feelings are presented as fact rather than just feelings, then I think it's perfectly legitimate to say, well, are you sure? You know, is that fact? Here's the facts. As a journalist, I can't help but say that surely facts should enter into conversations, and that fact-based conversation will be, in the long run, more civil
and
productive.
One argument in your favor comes from the Wall Street Journal today. Most students don't know when news is fake. According to a Stanford study, 82% of middle schoolers couldn't distinguish between ad-labeled sponsored content and a real news story on a website.
Well, that's not a fake news problem. That's a business
problem.
That's
the native content problem, and I've always thought that.
At CUNY, we have a study coming out shortly about a similar thing, not with just students, but with people. And here's the interesting thing, Leo. More people knew what was a sponsored story on Facebook than in news sites.
That doesn't surprise me.
More people on
Facebook is better labeled. Facebook has sponsored stuff is better labeled than news sites.
Right. And we've always said native content, whatever people say, is designed to trick the reader into thinking they're reading something that is not an advertisement. So that was part of the study. And 2 out of 3 middle schoolers couldn't see any valid reason to mistrust a post written by a bank executive arguing that young adults need more financial planning help. But here's the other side of it. 4 in 10 high school students believed, based on the headline, that a photo of deformed daisies on a photo sharing site provided strong evidence of toxic conditions near the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant in Japan, even though no source or location was given for the photo. So 4 out of 10 high school kids, 82% of middle school kids. That's a legitimate audience for what you're saying, you know, young people. But I do think that much of the, you know, so-called fake news posted during the election was posted by people who knew it wasn't the Pope didn't really endorse Donald Trump, but that's how they felt. That's what they were saying something by posting that.
They really thought that was true.
They really did.
Or they thought it would bolster their cause to the point they could convince others.
Okay, it would bolster their cause, right. By the way, I love this post. This is from 10 Zen Monkeys. Mark Zuckerberg is a hypocrite. Right next to, so this is Lou Cabran writing, right next to Mark Zuckerberg's post on November 18th. A lot of you asked what we're doing about misinformation. I wanted to give you an update. We take it seriously, blah, blah, blah. Right next to it on Lou's feed, maybe not yours, were two ads. Hugh Hefner ends his life. HollywoodLife.com, he will be missed. And Sad Day and PGA, ESPN.com, we've lost Tiger forever. Both were, of course, completely fake, and they were advertisements. This one pointed to a site that's labeled Fox News with shocking news. The headline, Crystal Hefner reveals the miracle pill that cured Hugh's ED permanently.
Oh, Jesus.
And sad day for PGA fans. That points to a site that does look like ESPN, except it's not. It's ESPN.com-magazine.online. And, of course, it ends up being a diet pill. So the point that Lou is making is Mark Zuckerberg can't keep this crap off his own posts. He's obviously got a problem here. We don't take misinformation seriously.
Well, worse yet, he's taking money for those.
He's made money on those.
Yeah.
That's more appalling to me. And not because I think anybody believes it, but just it's really annoying. It's just the worst kind of link bait. I also kind of don't like the fake news conversation, because I feel like it's a little whiny. It's like people complaining about the result of the election and looking for a scapegoat. I wish we had this conversation before the election.
Exactly. Or 6 months afterwards, that it was in a different context. It's not just about the election.
Because it really does feel like it's whiny.
Well, but I mean, that's how change happens. And that's how we decide something's important is, you know, I complained about data caps for freaking ever, but only, you know, only when a certain pain point had been reached, like when people are trying to download updates for video games or whatever, did it suddenly become a big issue, right? So this is, some people have been complaining about fake news,
right?
But no one cared until after it possibly cost someone an election.
I guess that's legitimate. And by the way, speaking of caps, hello, this is a courtesy notice from Comcast to let you know you've reached 100% of your terabyte monthly data plan for your Xfinity internet service. And actually, this is not the last one I got. The next one, a day later, said 110%. Yeah.
You've used a terabyte already?
Easy.
Oh, for broadcasting the show?
Wait, no, not in the office, at home.
Huh.
Easy. And I have two internet connections, by the way. I split it, and I still did it.
What are you doing?
I'm watching TV. But I noticed
a lot of television. 4K?
4K, baby.
Okay.
And the thing is, it doesn't take that much. If you stream Pandora, and we stream everything. Even if I'm going to watch an HBO show, I hate the Comcast On Demand so much that I'll end up watching it on HBO Go, which is streamed instead. So.
Yeah.
That still feels like a lot. I mean, we watch, you must. I mean,
oh, you'll get there. Oh, you'll get there.
Okay, no, I'm trying to think.
I'm a canary in the mine, baby.
We get 250 is probably how many, just 250 gigabytes. So
that's your cap?
No, that's how much we seem to use.
Oh.
So,
well, this is the first time I've ever gone through that cap, so maybe something is going on. I don't know. But, I mean, if you're downloading 4K or video, it's 15 gigs an hour. So
is it that high? Yeah. I thought it was down to 8.
Not
I thought
gigs. They had some 15 megabytes. 15 megabits an hour.
No,
what am I saying?
It would be gigabytes because HD is 2 gigabytes.
It's 15 megabits. I'm sorry. 15 megabits. So I have to do the math. Yeah. It's a lot. It's a lot.
It's a lot.
It's a lot.
All right.
I do think a terabyte, which sounds like a lot, is not. And it's really Comcast, you know, doing what they think people will ignore until such time. It's exactly what you said, Stacey.
I'm like, I have preached to this choir many a time.
Yeah. No, you nailed it. And as somebody who's now experiencing it, I will agree with you.
Oh, well,
this Pixel, I was going to say, go ahead, Stacey, sorry.
No, I was going to segue from fake news to Intel's wearable stuff, but we should stick with Google for a while before we go totally off track. So do your Pixel.
Let's do our Pixel phone thing. So a couple of things going on. Initially, we were getting reports. The Guardian reported that people who were buying the Pixel phone and then selling it on were getting not only blocked from their Pixel account, but their entire Google account. Now Google has unlocked those, has relented, according to Engadget. The digital death penalty has been lifted.
As someone who has often defended Google, this time I'm going to be the exact opposite. This was an abuse of power, straight and simple. This is exactly what people fear about Google tying accounts together, and it can use its power in one realm to enforce its view in the other realm. And I think it was a huge mistake for Google to kill these accounts.
Google does say in the terms of service, you may not resell devices purchased from an online store.
But we're going to cut you off from the entirety of all of the rest of Google, which controls half the world that Facebook doesn't control.
That's true.
And that's what's wrong. You know, no Google Maps for you, no Waze for you, no Gmail for you, no Docs for you, no search for you, because you did something we didn't like.
So Google says,
where's the limit?
Google says it's unlocking the accounts because customers weren't aware of the rule. But they also say many of the accounts were created for the sole purpose of this scheme. In other words, we created an account to buy a Pixel.
I'm just saying Google better be careful because you know, I just got back from Europe and it's the same view there as ever. And this is a case where I'll agree with the critics to say, watch out, Google. If you overuse this tremendous power you have, then the critics are going to get you, and they'll be right.
I mean, I kind of see their point, and I'm going to say, hey, I mean, giving it back to them because they didn't know the rule is good, because no one reads all of the terms of service. But I mean, you're abusing their accounts. There are alternatives out there, even if you don't like them. Just, it sucks for you, but you did.
It wouldn't matter if it were your Flickr account. I think, Jeff, this is kind of, I won't put words in your mouth, but because Google is so much more important than just, you know, an account, it's your
email, it's your browsing history.
It's a lot.
I mean,
it's everything now.
How would you do without a Google account? I guess you could get a different one, new one, right?
But you could lose all of your email.
I load everything. I mean, I save my contacts, not just to Google, but to my phone.
But you're
photos to Dropbox.
You're one of the few. I think most people do not, especially Gmail. How many people back up their Gmail? Do you?
I do. It's my brain.
Yeah, you're smart. I would recommend.
I also had a company go bust, so I was like, oh.
Yeah, that's right. When GigaOm went under, you had no warning, right?
I had an hour's warning, but they actually gave us our accounts for a little bit longer, so we had time to do a backup, but we didn't know we were going to have time to do a backup.
So, yeah, I mean, that's a significant deal. There are programs that will back up your entire Gmail account, and maybe this would be a good thing to consider. You can do it from Gmail directly. There's Google Takeout. There are programs that you can download, or you could actually use.
There should be companies. We talked about this in the past. There should be companies that just do this for you.
Yeah.
Back up all your stuff for you.
Yeah.
I'm surprised it's not an Amazon. What was it?
Backupify.
Backupify, but there was also like Spanning Cloud, but I think Google bought them. Google's going to buy you.
There's a Mac app I had that did this for you, and it did it continually in the background, downloaded it locally. Backupify was cloud backup, which is kind of cool. But anyway, it'd be easy for anybody to find this, but I would bet 99% of Google Mail users don't do that. That's a really unusual thing.
So Backupify is still around.
Oh. Yeah, they used to, when they first started, they had free backup services, and I think now it's all paid.
Someone's saying Mail Store will back up our sorter or
sorter.
I see it two ways.
Like, yeah. Yeah, I used Backupify for a long time. I think I was initially grandfathered in on a free account, but they got purchased in 2014. I think that they're not quite the service they were.
Oh, Mail Store, the standard in email archiving.
Nice. I like that.
Wait, there's one that's Mail Store with an E, and then there's Mail Store without an E.
There's two. Have you seen, and if you haven't, get ready, the new Google Duo ad with Blake and DeAndre?
Yes, it's DeAndre. So silly.
Isn't that Blake? I thought he said he had practice.
This is, by the way, that's a bottle of soda talking.
No, it's mustard.
Mustard.
Mustards.
Oh, they're looking right at us.
Mustard ketchup.
Nope, and now they're calling.
And okay, the mustard.
What do I say?
DeAndre's mustard is now duoing.
Hey, what's up?
Who are you dunking with over there?
What? No, I was just, what?
Man, I thought we were a team.
No, like, we are.
No, that's cool. You do you.
The mustard's doing his talking.
You do you.
Are you done?
I don't know.
You still coming to the party on Sunday?
I have plans.
There's going to be pigs in a blanket.
All right.
You're in?
I'm in.
That is vaguely obscene. For duos who can't stay mad at each other.
Hey, okay, so now since we're going, I'll come by and pick you up.
I'll just meet you there.
Perfect. I'll pick you up.
Who are Blake and DeAndre? Am I missing something?
They're NBA basketball players? Yeah.
Think so.
That's all I mean.
Are they?
If it's sports, it's out of my league.
Chat room. Yeah. We're not sport ballers here, but chat room, do you know who that is? No one knows who that is.
Is there any real American around?
They didn't want to spend the money on actual NBA players, so they got, I don't know. Does it make you want to use? Does it even give you any understanding of what Duo does?
Yes.
No, it does?
It does. It's quirky. I think it appeals maybe to younger people, maybe.
Okay, those two guys play for the LA Clippers, Steve Ballmer's team.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Oh, and they're advertising Google products?
Dun, dun,
dun. Trouble.
I mean, you can see that the guy's like, oh, crap, I know who's calling because I could see them on the screen, hold up. And he even knows that the guy, the mustard or ketchup, is mad at him because he's got the frowny face. I mean, it's silly.
And by the way, they knew that DeAndre could act because he apparently has one of the most famous reaction GIFs on Twitter. So that's how they knew. Nice. You know, it's easy to become a star these days. Just get on the Twitter.
Hell, anybody can become president that way.
Did you? Yeah. He's still tweeting.
Oh, yeah.
I'm thrilled. I think we are going to have the best unmediated view of the presidency we've ever had.
I don't think it's going to be the type of presidency, though, that has historically existed.
I'll tell you why.
A whole new realm.
We don't know what he's going to do, so we really need the Twitter to keep track. Because apparently, talking to the New York Times, he changed everything. It's like, well, yeah, I like the Clintons. I don't want to hurt them. And it's not really a wall. And I mean, so the Twitter is going to be very valuable in parsing all of this.
And meanwhile, reporters shouldn't be doing
Twitter account is actually valuable. I mean, it's not going to help us parse anything. It's just like his id speaking to us in 140 characters.
Yeah, I love it.
But the point is that Michael Wolff just said in an interview that, you know, the reporter's job is to be a stenographer. It is to listen to what they say. We don't need that anymore.
No.
Because he can reach directly and whatever he wants to say to the world, he can say
to the
world.
Well, look at that. He made a YouTube video saying, here's my policy. I don't need the press. Here's my policy.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
That's the equivalent of FDR's fireside chats. That's going right to the public and bypassing all the gatekeepers.
Now he just has to make it
happen. To other tasks.
Very interesting article. Was it Bloomberg Business Week about Jared Kushner, who apparently, that's, of course, President-elect Trump's son-in-law. He's married to Ivanka. He is apparently the architect of this social media strategy. It's quite interesting. Let me see if I can find this article, because I thought this was really... this. You know, we often talk about how President Nixon, there it is. President Nixon was the first president to use an ad agency in his election bid in 68. And how Obama is in many ways the first social media president. But what Kushner figured out and did so well was how to not spend money traditionally on advertising. It's Forbes that did the interview. Not spend money in traditional advertising, but instead very cleverly use Facebook. And it starts with a company called Cambridge Analytica. And I just found this endlessly fascinating. Do you guys follow this whole story? Cambridge Analytica.
Yeah, there's another story about them. They've been doing these polls on Facebook. Is that the one?
Yeah. So Cambridge Analytica has been around for a while. They specialize in... I don't know. How would you characterize it? Let's go to their website.
Character polls.
Better audience targeting powered by smarter data modeling. So what they've been doing, what they were doing, is doing quizzes on Facebook. You've probably seen these. We've all taken them. Personality quizzes. And they just seem like a lot of fun. Yeah, but, you know, everybody does it. Let's do one here. Let's get to know your real personality. This is actually on the Cambridge Analytica site. I have a vivid imagination. Yeah, I definitely do. I believe in the importance of art. Strongly agree. I seldom feel blue. Nah, no, I feel blue. I have a sharp tongue. Oh, God, yes. I'm not interested in abstract ideas. No, I don't. I like abstract. I find it difficult to get down to work. I'm doing this fast. I do not panic easily. I tend to vote for liberal. Oh, this is interesting. Mm-hmm. Liberal political candidates, yes. I'm not easily bothered by things.
Only two Republican candidates.
Yeah. So what they'll do is these quizzes, and if they don't all look like this, you know, it's often which member of the Downton Abbey family are you, right? We've all done these. But what they were doing behind the scenes is gathering information, very, very elaborate databases on Facebook users, which they then used to target what they're calling dark advertising. And I found this very interesting. And it was shortly after Trump won the Republican nomination that Kushner went to Cambridge Analytica and hired them. And they started spending money. He calls it, he says, this is like Moneyball. Remember Moneyball was that wonderful book about how the Boston Red Sox became world champions. No, I'm sorry, Oakland A's became world champions. The Red Sox use it later. Using analytics, finding players that were undervalued. Nobody wanted because they didn't really fully understand their value. But modern data analytics let them know which players were worth, you know, getting, even though they were cheap because nobody knew how valuable they were. And of course, it created a winning Oakland A's team and then later a winning Boston Red Sox team. And this season, a winning Chicago Cubs team. The same exact technique Kushner used to targeting its advertising very effectively. For instance, this is from the Forbes article. At first, Kushner dabbled, engaging in what amounted to a beta test using Trump merchandise. He says, I called somebody I knew, and I got a tutorial on how to use Facebook micro-targeting. Synced with Trump's blunt, simple messaging, the Trump campaign went from selling $8,000 worth of hats a day to $80,000, generating revenue, expanding the number of human billboards, but most importantly, proving a concept. Then he spent $160,000 for a series of low-tech policy videos of Trump talking straight into the camera, got 74 million views. They actually had an organization in San Antonio with a 100-person data hub collecting information. But the best thing he did was he hired Cambridge Analytica to buy dark ads specifically targeting people, because it knew a lot about your Facebook interests and habits, not nearly about your bent. But for instance, if your worldview was grim, they would show you ads that were kind of, the world sucks and we're going to make it better. If you were an optimist, they'd show you a different kind of ad. They micro-targeted to your emotional tenor, your personality, and very...
You want to feel like a violation of privacy of your own head. It's not Facebook that knows that. It's a company that made you do these stupid quizzes that can then type you and knows the true psychographics of where you are.
Ineffective ads were killed in minutes. Successful ones scaled. The campaign was sending more than 100,000 uniquely tweaked ads to targeted voters each day.
So imagine this. Now, right now, this is pretty unsophisticated. I know it sounds super sophisticated, but imagine it even more targeted, more individualized, and happening faster, because you have access to AI that can parse people's emotions and do this A/B testing even faster. And I mean, that's the world we're going to live in. That's the advertising world we're going to live in. So, I mean, maybe it's just, it'll be more of the same. I mean, you can't stop this.
No. And you know what? It'll be the next time the Democrats will use it, because this is now known.
Super effective.
And it's very effective. And so I think what's important is that we understand what's going on here, because this is, I think this is going to be widely used. And this is why I brought in the context of Nixon was the first person to bring in ad executives. And that was a revolution, believe it or not, 1968, to have ad execs creating your advertising. And it was very effective. And Obama was very effective in fundraising in 2008, bringing in a whole data team. People like Harper Reed and very cleverly use this, but this has been taken to the next level, absolutely.
So it really goes to a larger question, not just in campaigns, but about advertising ethically all around and what's known about.
Well, is this unethical?
It's
creepy.
It's creepy. I think that it's. I'll give you a scenario for a lack of ethics in a second, but I think it goes back to also the Vance Packard and the hidden persuaders from
the
50s.
That's right.
Right. This idea that we were being sold things in ways we didn't know. There was a lack of transparency about it. It was subliminal advertising. Well, this calls on those same creep reflexes. The way it could be. I mean, I've told the story on the show before. The guy on Facebook who talked with his family about symptoms he was feeling, and then suddenly an ad for multiple sclerosis came up. That's how he died. That's how he got the diagnosis.
That's so weird.
Now, that case, I would argue that's very helpful in that case. He didn't know what he had. It found the signals, and nobody was making money on that, really. The ad was there, but it was kind of another here and there. Whereas in this case, it's manipulative to the extreme. The real question, just as when you go back to the hidden persuaders, is how much are we being manipulated in ways we don't know? The lack of transparency. If you know it's native advertising too. If you know it's an ad and you choose to pay attention to it or not, that's your privilege. But to have things that are masquerading not as ads but as fun quizzes that are then used to change your view of the world and elect a president, at some point, there's ethics. Now, Stacey's absolutely right. Even if you have a community that has an ethical statement around this, others will say, damn the ethics, full speed ahead, and use these techniques. And I don't know what to do about it, but it bothers me.
This is almost one of the reasons why I don't think fake news is as much the issue. Because if fake news were blocked on Facebook, you'd still be getting
wouldn't have made it.
The material would still be coming through. Cambridge Analytica is a spinoff of a British consulting company and sometime defense contractor. This is from Mackenzie Funk's op-ed. By the way, this is an op-ed piece in the New York Times. I don't know if that has different standards for fact checking, Jeff, or. But it's on the opinion pages. A spin. I don't know what that means.
The New York Times does work over these things with authors, and I don't think they'd publish something they knew was false.
Okay.
No.
So sometimes defense contractors are known for, get this, it's counterterrorism psyops work in Afghanistan. They claim that they have psychological profiles of 230 million adult Americans. 230 million, I should point out, only about 130 million voted. So they have more.
There's only about 310 million of us.
Yeah, they have more profiles than people voted. They worked for the Brexit campaign. Worked for Cruz in the primaries. Trump hired them for the general. And Steve Bannon is a board member. So they claim as many as 3,000 to 5,000 data points on each of us: voting histories, demographics, age, income, debt, hobbies, criminal histories, purchase histories, religious leanings, health concerns, gun ownerships.
So here's a question, Leo. Here's another way to look at it. If you have a right to get to your credit history because it can have an impact on your life, should you have a right to get to this data? Should your data about you be transparent as an ethical standard or as a law? How people use it, what's done with it? Do you have the opportunity to correct it? This precedent is there when it comes to credit because there's a one-on-one affiliation as to whether or not you're going to get a mortgage. Well, employers could use this data. Political campaigns can use this data. Creditors could use this data to look at your credit worthiness. There are companies out there that do that right now. Should there be laws demanding transparency of this stuff?
It was also used, according to this piece, to suppress voting. So not only can it be used to influence your vote, but according to Bloomberg, the Trump campaign sent out ads reminding certain selected black voters of Hillary Clinton's infamous super predator line. It targeted Miami's Little Haiti neighborhood with messages about the Clinton Foundation's trouble in Haiti after the earthquake. So it can be used for voter suppression as well. I mean, it's just like any ad. You're trying to get somebody to do something. Sometimes it's to vote for your guy. Sometimes it's not to vote at all. But what's interesting is how effective it was. The campaign spent much less than the Clinton campaign, and I would argue got a hell of a lot more for their money.
Mm-hmm. Well, it also shows, I mean, if I were a TV network reading this, I mean, I'm already stressed, but now I'm even more stressed because it's bang for your buck. Micro-targeting looks better for getting something done. So that's worse news for the media industry and those guys trying to scale. I would say, I would caution though, before we freak out too much, and I agree that transparency would be good, but we don't actually know how accurate this data is. And I know that I go through and I click on things just to mess with algorithms because it's fun to see what happens. You know, it's fun to like do these little experiments and be like, oh, hey, let's try this. Oh, now I'm getting served, you know, this type of advertisement. So it's possible that this panopticon has really blurry vision, for lack of a better word.
Yeah, I think you're being optimistic. I think your stray signals don't overwhelm a much larger group of signals that you are unwittingly sending out all the time. And I think if somebody is determined to get your stuff, and what is, by the way, unethical is the quiz thing, you know, getting that information.
Well, it's putting up a quiz and saying, hey, this is for entertainment purposes, and then using it to create a psychographic profile.
So I agree. I think you're smart to try to game the system a little bit, Stacey, but you're going to have to work harder.
I'm going to have to work so hard because I have so many connected devices.
Right. You're sending out so much data smog I think you could try to mess with it all day long, and it wouldn't make that much difference.
Well, in certain signals are going to, I mean, they're going to figure out which signals correlate more highly. And if you think about like your camera, you know, when you're reading something, it can tell if you're getting emotional about it by looking at, you know, the flush in your face
right. And
all of that. Then you're like, holy cow, even if I click on something completely unrelated, it'll know I'm lying.
One defense against this is knowing it's happening, so that when you start seeing ads of a certain kind, for instance, in this Times article, the author posits, well, you know, if you're if they know you're a gun owner who is paranoid and concerned about the world, they're going to send you a negative ad where, you know, I mean, they're going to really target you based on emotional analysis as much as factual analysis. That's why. And by the way, Facebook makes a lot of money on this. This is why Facebook had such a good quarter. Mm-hmm. You know, why mobile's working so well for them is because all this time, that's really what they've been doing. In fact, I don't see it changing. They've been gathering information about you to be used in this extraordinarily targeted way. And the reason they call them dark posts, and the reason most of us probably aren't even aware of this, is because it's only seen by those highly targeted individuals. The rest of us will never see it. So I didn't see a lot of fake news in my Facebook feed, and I certainly didn't see any of these posts. Probably because Cambridge Analytica knew full well there was no point in wasting money on me. I think this is it's a brave new world, and it doesn't just have to do with presidential elections, obviously.
No.
Right.
And go ahead, Stacey.
No, I was gonna say, hey, Jeff, your idea about seeing this data and having access to it, but every company is trying to gather these sorts of profiles on people, and they might be using slightly different signals, but and the government has shown no interest so far in regulating or even looking at this. The FTC,
it ain't gonna happen now.
if you got elected president using it, I can pretty much guarantee you, you're not gonna mess with
it.
That's a good system. By the way, on Monday, we already did the interview, but we're going to air it on Monday on Triangulation. We interviewed a mathematician, Kathy O'Neill, who wrote a book called Weapons of Math Destruction.
That was going to be my pick of the day.
Really?
Yeah.
Good. Well, I'll let you talk about it. That after you do your pick, if people want to watch that interview, that'll be on Monday's Triangulation. She was great. Do you know her?
I don't know her, but I read about the book from, it popped up in my Twitter feed at some point. I was like, this sounds amazing. Former quant person who was like,
she was at D.E. Shaw, and she got her eyes opened and joined the Occupy Wall Street movement, like went completely opposite. Because she's a mathematician and she understands how math is being used in some ways that are less than
highly detrimental to the people.
Yes. Salubrious. Let's take a break. Come back with more. This is good discussion. What did you want to talk about, Stacey? You had some, was it Facebook?
I was going to talk about Intel, but I also wanted to talk about Google's AI paper, because that's actually really interesting.
Lip reading, yeah, kids.
Really interesting. Really, really interesting.
But first, let's talk to the geeks among us. That's all of you, I presume, about Rocket Mortgage. There are people in your family, people you may even be having Thanksgiving with tomorrow, who like the way things used to be. And they want to go through their papers and bring a stack of papers in a folder, or maybe even like one of those big banker's boxes, to the mortgage loan officer. And he'll go through it all, and he'll look at the, he'll have all the papers, and he goes, well, let me find a loan that's right for you. He'll lick his fingers and page through the, and eventually, how long did it take us to get our mortgage? A month, right? Last time forever. Last time. It was ridiculous. They kept saying more, more, more. Man, that was a few years ago when Lisa and I bought our house. But nowadays, man, we'd be using Rocket Mortgage. Rocket Mortgage does the whole thing completely online. Completely. You even can submit your pay stubs and your bank statements and everything. They have a very simple questionnaire. It's kind of fun. It's like a Facebook quiz almost. You go through it, and by the time you're done, they will have a loan for you that fits your exact financial situation. I mean, we're talking minutes here, and you don't even have to get up from the couch. You can do it on your phone. You can do it on your tablet. That's why Quicken Loans calls it Rocket Mortgage. Quicken Loans, of course, the best mortgage lender in the country, and they have put together a product that is just right for us geeks. Go to quickenloans.com/twig right now to find out about Rocket Mortgage. Join the 21st century with a completely online process that's fast, easy, gets the job done, all from the convenience of your couch. Actually, they have a video on there of a couple at an open house. You know, sometimes you do that, right? You go looking around. You're not going to buy a house. You just want to see what the neighbor's house looks like or whatever. Then suddenly you get this house and you go, ooh, gosh, we should buy this house. So this couple is there at the open house, and they go to quickenloans.com/twig, of course, and do the Rocket Mortgage. And before they leave the open house, they say, we're approved. We'll take it. Quickenloans.com/twig. Equal housing lender licensed in all 50 states. NMLSconsumeraccess.org, number 3030. Rocket Mortgage, the 21st century's answer to the home loan or the refi. We're talking about Google. We're talking about journalism. We're talking about social media. We're talking about a changing world. That's really what this show is ultimately all about. The world changing around us and how big data, technology, the internet are changing everything. And boy, we got two of the best people to do that. Stacey Higginbotham is here. She's the expert on Internet of Things. Really has made that her beat. She's got Stacey on IoT.com and the IoTpodcast.com. Also with us, Jeff Jarvis, who's been a media watcher forever and is a professor of journalism at CUNY, the City University of New York, author of many books, including What Would Google Do? Public Parts, Gutenberg the Geek, Geeks Bearing Gifts About Reinventing the News Industry, and his blog is at buzzmachine.com. So you weren't you out here for an Intel thing, Stacey?
Did you? Oh, I was. Yeah. I was out here for, IDF a while back.
The Developers Forum, that's what it was, yeah.
Yes.
So what is Intel up to? This isn't stuff you learned at IDF, this is more recent.
Well, who knows what Intel's up to? There were two stories. There were two stories here. One was they did the roadmap for AI chips, which was really important. And we've talked about a lot of that before, like when they bought Nirvana systems.
I have to say, Intel is right now in a kind of a desperate situation where they were the chip maker to the world. The PC revolution happened thanks to Intel. And now we're in a rapidly moving to a post-PC era where Intel chips have no role. It's all ARM chips made by companies like Qualcomm and Apple and Samsung.
And so they
need to reinvent themselves.
They do. And they're also stuck as things, AI is happening. They've got to figure out how to make their chip work for that. Basically, in a nutshell, Intel sold itself as a general purpose computing powerhouse. But because of battery power on one side and a massive scale in putting like single monolithic apps in the cloud at massive scale, special purpose computing is actually the win right now. So they're like a general purpose computing vendor in a special purpose computing.
And that includes IoT, of course.
It does. I mean, it includes pretty much everything going forward. So, I mean, you look at like Google and its TensorFlow processors as an example of this. Facebook building a lot of their AI stuff on GPUs. So Intel, so that's the big macro thing. So the next big hurdle for Intel after it flubbed mobile, it was like, holy cow, we've got to do something about AI. And what they've done is actually they've embraced heterogeneous compute. So they bought Nirvana Systems, which actually is building out a cloud and a special processor that looks more like a graphics processor. Their original stuff is based on NVIDIA's GPUs, actually, and they just modded the firmware. So that's part of it. And then they bought a company called Movidius for their computer vision at the edge and their AI kind of stuff at the edge. So they talked about that in a special, they released some software and they kind of gave their roadmap for AI, and it's built all on that. So that was the one thing that Intel was doing. And then the other thing that, I don't know if this is fake news or what, but you know, there was a story in TechCrunch that Intel was laying off its wearables division.
Yeah, I saw that. I don't think that's fake news.
Well, yeah, I was like, is it real? Intel doesn't, they're like denying it, but they're not really addressing it. So
it wouldn't be fake news, but TechCrunch might have got it wrong.
Right. Sorry, fake news is not, this is not large enough to be fake news, I guess.
You read that article about the two guys in the Newport Beach or wherever in Southern California who used to work in a Mexican restaurant, but they couldn't make any money doing that, so they created one of the most popular fake news sites on the net. And they're not political. They just want to sell ads. They just, they're making good money. They didn't even want to, in the New York Times article, they didn't talk about how much money they were making because they were afraid people would hit them up.
It's ridiculous.
It's good money, that fake news. I don't think TechCrunch is in that business, I hope.
No. It's unclear how accurate. I'm not 100% sure how accurate this is, but
wearables is not the story, I don't think. I think if Google, it's too early to know what wearable's going to win, whether it's a Snapchat goggle or virtual reality or augmented reality headset or a ring or a earpiece, or that's not even important. What's important is the machine learning and AI behind it, right? So they're smart to go
yes,
into that direction.
They are. Well, and again, wearables, depending on your wearable, you really do need a specialized processor for each one because the battery life and because the form factor is so small.
Right.
So again, specialized.
But if you could do AI hardware, people have always said this. This is what Jeff Hawkins went to work on. He was the founder of Graffiti and created Palm. And he took all his money and has sunk it into a company called Numenta, which is trying to make memory chips and eventually processor chips that work like the human brain does, not like a von Neumann device does, but as a massively parallel brain-like processor. And I think that probably makes sense. Problem is, silicon is so, you know, fixed and immutable.
Well, that's why Intel bought into FPGAs with
right. You could reprogram them, right? Yeah. And eventually, I guess they could program themselves.
That feels some next level stuff.
Isn't that
right
what
there.
You want, though? You would want a machine that gets smarter, and as it gets smarter, can improve its hardware continuously. That's what you'd want. Or is that too sci-fi?
I feel like I'm picturing the Terminator, like skin shifting. And I'm like, oh my God, that's scary as all get out.
Well, not a brand new idea. The original artificial intelligence language created by John McCarthy, Lisp, was designed to be a language for building artificial intelligence. And one of its chief abilities, it's a kind of a meta language, is you can create new languages with Lisp. And you can use Lisp to write new languages.
And it's about linguistics itself.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely. McCarthy was a linguist. But I think the idea is, in software, in fact, they even tried to make Lisp machines. They made Lisp machines for a while. Makes sense to have that same kind of capability in hardware.
Well, so what Microsoft has built with their FPGAs and for Azure Cloud is not quite, it doesn't program itself, but you can actually, they've created basically a networking stack, or it's virtualized networking, basically, that will run any protocol you want. So you just basically tell it and it reconfigures itself as needed, which is really powerful. And so it's not crazy to think, that you could redesign your silicon as needed in an FPGA, but that
field programmable
gate array
field programmable implies to me that it's something that could be reprogrammed.
It is reprogrammed. So you can reprogram. I'm just thinking it's like it's a chip design effort. So it's not.
It's a soft chip.
It's a soft chip, but it's still, it's a pretty esoteric set of skills, which might make it great for computers. I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not enough of a computer programmer or not a computer chip designer to know how this works at that level.
But if Intel says, well, we still want to be in the hardware business, we still want to, you know, I mean, Intel's big asset right now is all those chip fabs, those buildings billion-dollar to $10 billion factories designed to make chips.
Which is something you just can't ever 3D print.
Right.
They're already selling. I mean, they have a foundry deal with a couple companies, and they will make ARM chips now. So they have that. I think they also have a huge, I mean, they have huge software assets in code base for, all of their x86. And the x86 license is nothing to scoff at. They own that.
Yeah, but it's kind of like IBM owning its patents. It's like, that's fine. It's kind of an annuity, but it doesn't build a long-term
future of
growth.
No, but it's enough to give them a runway to play with and figure this out. And they're really, like, for a while there, I was really worried that they weren't going to see this and accept it, but thank God they did. At this point,
somebody in the chat room said Intel's turning into Yahoo, and I can't say I disagree with them. It's, That's what happens. Come on. This is the business cycle. You know, nothing can, especially in technology, with the innovator's dilemma and all that, it's very difficult for a company.
Well, the innovator's dilemma was originally an Intel thing. I mean, if you remember, Intel used to make their own chip manufacturing machines, and then they were like, oh, that is a loser business for us. We got to, like, they have adapted. I refuse to bet against Intel just yet because I do think Brian Krzanich has recognized where they are and is seeking ways to fix that.
Oh, of course. And look, anybody who's smart knows and sees, things changing. It's a little harder right now, at least it is for me, to think of where the future lies. For decades, we kind of knew, computers are going to get smaller. We're going to have they're going to be always on, always connected. They're going to become portable ultimately. I mean, we kind of knew where we were headed. I think that there is a pretty big question mark at this point about, I mean, we know machine learning and artificial intelligence will be applied as a thin veneer to existing technology. So I guess a new company could look at, or an old company could look at a growth path that involves that. But it's often easier to do that for a new company than it is for an older company.
It is. Well, and Intel's challenge is also that the ASPs on its chips, so the average selling price of its chips, is incredibly high.
Right.
And when you talk about chips for things that are, selling for $50 or $200.
Right.
It's...
Look at the Raspberry Pi, a $35 computer. What is it having in it? An ARM chip.
It has a Broadcom chip.
Yep.
Based on ARM.
We were talking just a minute ago on Windows Weekly about Microsoft moving to ARM and Windows on ARM. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and, VMware goes there, then all is lost.
There's a lot. Yeah, right. There's a virtualization ARM. And there's a lot of conversation about Apple abandoning Intel. And I think this is obviously Intel sees this coming. And turning to ARM, and eventually, it is ultimately the death of the PC platform is that we're looking at. And
yeah, Intel it's again that. Mm-hmm. End of general purpose computing.
Right.
So.
Yep.
Sorry, I'm just going to hammer that point home because I feel like a lot of people talk about it without seeing the big picture.
Right. Well, and I'll tell you why. It's just kind of the innovator's dilemma for journalists. I grew up with general purpose desktop computers, and I kind of like them. And
they're
a lot
for creating content.
Yeah, well, a lot of us. But I think we're wrong. But a lot of us kind of go, oh, they can't get rid of the Mac. They can't get rid of the PC. We can't. We gotta. Who's gonna write the software? Who's gonna design
this?
This
was the resistance to the Chromebook.
Right. Okay. Yes.
This is the resistance. How can I not run my own apps? How can I not make my own?
I freely admit that time is not on our side. I'm just being nostalgic at this point. Yeah, Gramps.
Yep. Grumpy Gramps.
I was like, you're close to retirement. It's all good.
Oh, shut up. I want to go another 30 years. I'm hoping is that somebody who... I think I still have a nimble enough mind to kind of embrace the new hotness. And what I do bring to the table, you young people, is enough... history and background to be a little cynical sometimes about the things that, like VR, that everybody's jumping up and down over and say, well, I think that emperor's not wearing any clothes. And by the way, IoT is inevitable. I mean, that's obvious. We've been saying for decades. I've been saying for decades what you're going to see. I mean, this was another trend. It was plainly obvious. Is the distribution of computing power? That's what the personal computer did. In effect, it took the mainframe computer and put it on your desk, and then it's in your pocket, and then soon it's going to be everywhere. It's going to be in your TV and your microwave and your toaster and your mouse, and of course the next step to that is to have improved communication between them, which we're not very good at right now.
Right.
And unfortunately, market forces argue against, because everybody wants their stuff siloed, and that's why we've never had a good standard that everybody had adopted, and because everybody wanted to own their own thing, and that's keeping that from going where it should go, which is a mesh of interconnected, self-aware, intelligent items. Once you get that, that's pretty powerful.
It is. I'm kind of curious. So I feel like we're getting closer, though, actually, with a usability standard for the Internet of Things, and that would be voice. And you see it with the evolution of the different voice platforms, because I feel like at some level, all these fights over protocols can be obviated by running it through like an Echo or a Home or some other device that you talk to. And this kind of popped up in my head because I was like, I was in my car, which I can talk to. And I was like, dang it. I really want to talk to, you know, the Echo in my car. I want to ask.
I know. Everybody wants to put a dot in their car or a tap in their car.
So I was thinking about that, and I'm like, okay, so what we're going to end up with isn't maybe a standard that everyone works with. It's going to be some sort of hub for now that's controlled by one of the three vendors. And, you know, we've kind of on this bet that it's going to be the best AI, and that'll be Google. But maybe it's the best ecosystem, and that'll be Amazon. And I don't know what happens with Apple, because they dropped the ball on this whole ecosystem idea of things.
Maybe it's the company that can buy the best Facebook targeted advertising. Who knows?
Or the best dark ads.
I mean, but that's what I'm saying is that the thing that really holds us back at this point, it's not security, it's not user adoption, it's none of the things that have in the past held us back. It's the sad to say, the intense desire of companies to silo everything and to keep everything in their own ecosystem. And the reason you don't have an Echo in the car is because no auto manufacturer will allow you to do that, because Ford wants you to use its technology. And
or Android Auto.
Well, same thing with Android Auto, right. That seems to me a no-brainer. That's what everybody wants. It doesn't matter what consumers want. The companies, Mercedes is over my dead body, right? It's not going to be an...
Actually, Mercedes is adding Android Auto.
Yeah, but watch how they add it. Seriously.
Ford is adding Alexa. Sorry.
They are?
Ford is adding the Echo. Yeah.
Are they? Did
it, they announced it at CES last year.
Really?
Yeah, where is that right? Last year, huh?
they announced... Okay. Yeah. You're
last year they announced that, huh?
I don't have a
They're really
car.
Running along, moving along on that one.
All right.
I think people are scared of Amazon. They're scared of Jeff Bezos. And I think a lot of companies that thought Echo was a great platform now are going, yeah, but all we're going to do is give Jeff Bezos all our data, and then he's just going to take over the world.
You know, Apple's trying to do that with their home platform for the Internet of Things.
And and look how slowly that's evolving.
Well, that's evolving because that's evolving slowly for a number of reasons. Not all of them are about... A lot of them were technical at the first iteration.
I would submit that ultimately the reason that it doesn't evolve is because everybody's scared of Apple.
No, they don't. No, everybody wants to be with Apple, but Apple's setting these weird rules and it's not clear how everything's going to work. And Apple wants things to be more clear, but it's not clear because there's no standards. And
Apple,
it's like,
here's what it is. And I'll tell you right now, it's the same reason Apple hasn't been able to get the TV companies to go along with its plans for Apple TV. Apple wants to own the data.
Mm-hmm.
Apple's insistent on owning the data, and they.
But how much can Apple really? And you know, can Apple get a broad swath of data? And this is what we've talked about before. Everybody has slices of data based on certain behaviors you have. Who has the broad swath?
Facebook,
Amazon, yep. Facebook,
yep.
Google.
Yeah, and Apple uses as an excuse that they want to own the data. They want to protect their users' privacy, so they don't trust anybody else to have the data. You know, maybe that's true, or maybe they just want to have the data because that's where all the money is.
It's also an easier customer relationship. So that's a big hitching point with Home, is the companies who are building products that work with HomeKit. Apple wants, you as the end user to be able to use that app for everything instead of having to deal with all these, like a door lock app, a garage door app, a whatever, doorbell app. It wants to show you everything in the home app, so your life is easier as a user. But if you're one of those partner companies, you're like, no, no, I want them in my app because I want to own that relationship with the customer. So it's not just, it's not just about getting data. It's also because Apple does think about the user and their experience to a crazy amount.
So here's an October article from Fortune. Thank you, chat room, that said final testing is underway for Echo integration into Ford Motors. By the end of this year, the Focus Electric, Fusion Energy, and C-Max Energy, all of these are electric cars, will be able to communicate. See, this is not as interesting. With smart home devices using Alexa by pressing a voice recognition button on the steering wheel. I want to talk to the car. I don't want to talk to my thermostat. So it's not, so you can't say, it doesn't sound like. It says vehicle owners will be able to send simple commands via Echo to smart home appliances and systems. It doesn't sound like I'll be able to say,
manage your car.
Echo, I want to listen to the top 100 records right now.
Oh, like streaming Spotify into your car.
Yeah.
I don't know. And you know, Amazon just this month, like just this week, I think, made it very easy. They released an SDK for speakers. So if you were an automaker, you could actually put that in and create like an Echo speaker.
Well, but as consumers, we would all love it if everybody would adopt Echo. I mean, that would be a start anyway, somebody. Mm-hmm. But
we learned that with trusting Apple, remember, with music and everything else. Right. Like that kind of the industry is skittish. And then Amazon and books, good Lord. Good Lord.
Good Lord.
The Kindle and publishing.
Right. Well, yeah, because there's a direct correlation between the success of a company and a company's platform and its desire to take over the world. And of course, as soon as that becomes apparent, everybody says, well, maybe we won't work with you after all. That's why how long have we been trying to connect all this stuff together? Forever.
That's why we can't have nice things.
Yes. I'm a fan of open platforms. That way no one company controls it. Everything works with everything else. That doesn't seem to be the future in any of this stuff.
Open platforms do not guarantee interoperability. And people are always like, oh, I'm a fan of open platforms, but
I don't say it like that.
Sorry.
I'm a fan of open platforms.
Oh, I love open platforms.
I do love open platforms.
I do too. I think they're just the bomb. But it doesn't guarantee interoperability. And that's actually what most people care about.
No, yeah, of course. We want one ring to rule them all.
Right. And no one actually.
But nobody wants to give Mordor all that power.
Right.
Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade will be live streamed on YouTube tomorrow in 360-degree video. Get your daydreams out, your Google Cardboard, your Galaxy Gear VRs. You can.
I left my cardboard at home.
No. Oh. You could probably make one with a newspaper and some glasses.
Newspaper and some glasses.
I don't know. Oh, maybe you don't have any VR capability there at all?
No, I don't think so.
You can watch
it. My daughter would love that.
Well, you can watch it from your browser, but you just don't get the surround. You have to move it around like that.
Yeah.
Verizon's doing this with NBC Universal. Verizon's going to place cameras in 5 locations along the parade route so you can follow your favorite balloon. Will there be there should be a Trump balloon. I think that'd be interesting.
Insert joke about hot air here.
In the run-up to the actual event, which is, of course, tomorrow, 9 a.m. Eastern, Macy's is also posting 360-degree videos of behind-the-scenes studio tours. Wait a minute. Let's see. It's time for the parade. This is the best PR.
Welcome to Macy's Studio.
Look. Now, this is in a weird...
This is where all of the magic begins. For
he's looking over here.
You want to come see how it works? Let's go. All around the ceiling are models of balloons. Snoopy has actually had 7 different designs.
Look, there's
Mickey Mouse has had 5 different designs of balloons for the parade. They all start out.
They put
out
a lot of work
way.
Into this.
We start with a.
Wouldn't your daughter love this?
Like this one of Spider-Man.
Yes.
And that shows us
what
he
that
looks
shark
like
doing in the corner
when he's coming.
That's
down
left
the
shark.
Route.
He finally got a job. The treasure chest.
Sketch, we've got to go to three dimensions. And that means doing a sculpt. So we sculpt them out of clay.
There's a clown.
So
in
that we
background.
Can look at them from top and bottom and all around and know exactly the proportions.
Like I was
and
the
how
left
going
shark
look.
In the
and
Mason's
we do it
Braid
in scale.
Studio video.
So this is not, I was hoping this would be one where you could watch it in 2D and move around inside, but it doesn't look like it's done that way. It's 4K too, by the way.
Here goes another gigabyte.
Yeah. Now you know why I've gone over the limit.
Someone said it. You can only watch like 88 hours of 4K TV.
Oh, I can watch a lot more.
Yes.
I have Comcast Consumer, and that's the one that's gone past the limit because I also have Comcast Business, which has no limit. And so what I'm trying now to do is move all my 4K stuff over to the Comcast Business Class.
Yeah, good plan.
Which is probably not what you're... Forget I said that. Me?
You're in the... No, it is business for you.
No, it's business. Oh, it's that's business class. You're fine.
Okay. Whew. So
that's what they always say. They're like, if you consume too much, you should be on a business line.
Yeah, I pay for it. It's a lot of money. It's like $200
a month. Yeah, what is it?
I don't know. It's a ton. I think it's 100 some... Between 100 and 200 a month.
Yeah. That's actually relative. I mean, for naked, it's just for internet?
For naked internet?
Naked broadband?
I'm happy. It's 100 megabit. Mm-hmm. I'm happy. I put servers on it. That's the main reason I have it is I have all my servers on it. So, yeah, I don't have Sonic at home. I don't have fiber to my house. I'm sad. So Google is now reading lips, and it's doing so better than humans do. Is it Google that's doing the lip reading? This is this the same thing as their multilingual neural machine translation system called Zero Shot Translation? I don't know. I saw the lip reading
this
somewhere too.
This is DeepMind. This is their
DeepMind.
This is the neural network.
Oh, this is the one where it's more sentence-y stuff, right?
It allowed them to do pairs that they never did before.
And it teaches itself to some extent, right?
So remember the scary scene in 2001 Space Odyssey where HAL 9000 reads Dave's lips? We're getting there. Google DeepMind AI destroys human expert in lip reading competition. The accuracy
is... real competition? Or just a test?
This is just a test. The professional lip reader... No, I don't think there's a lip reading competition.
That's what I was like.
Lip reading Olympics. Da, 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 da.
Christopher Guest should totally
the
make that.
The thrill
movie.
Of victory, okay. The agony of the lips. This. The professional human lip reader, whom the researchers compared the results against, had roughly 10 years of experience in the field and had deciphered videos for the royal wedding and in court for trials as well. The reader was given a sample of 200 videos from the set used to train WLAS, and the videos played for 10 times longer. In other words, they gave the human a huge advantage, 10 times longer than for the AI system. The human was able to decipher less than one quarter of the words in the sample. The Google Mind could do half. The human expert deciphered 12. This is a report from New Scientist. Human expert deciphered 12.4% of their words. The AI system got 46.8%.
Now, this got the words, but it didn't get the understanding.
You'd have to
run that through a new neural network. I'm just telling people who are, like, freaking out.
Right. Right. So how could know what you say but not what it meant?
Right. So actually, that's really interesting because you could do translations. Like, it could actually deliver words in other languages and then feed those words to somebody who could then translate.
Look, this is an example of the video. Can you understand what she's saying?
No, I can't read those. No.
You could do the bad lip dub with this. I love that. And here's the clip with the subtitles provided by the AI. We have to look at whether it works for the UK or not. We have to look at whether... She's got an accent. We have to
do this for
whether
the bad,
the
bad lip reading.
Well, it doesn't matter if it has an accent. Well, I guess it matters if it's a different face.
I can tell when I'm looking at her that she's speaking in an accent because...
In that plummy...
Or not.
British accent.
It's the or not is the giveaway. Or not. Or not. Hmm. AI shows the way, says New Scientist. Wow. I mean, it wasn't, it's not just random video they had to you know, get some special videos, et cetera, et cetera. But the Google engineer thinks lip reading AIs are most likely to be using consumer devices to help them figure out what we're trying to say.
Oh.
Isn't that interesting? To assist them, we believe machine lip readers have enormous practical potential with applications in improving hearing aids, silent dictation in public spaces. So you don't have to talk to Siri.
You don't have to make a fool of yourself.
You could just lip
Siri.
It.
Siri. Hey, Siri.
I feel like, hold on.
In a noisy environment.
Don't actually, hold on. I'm going to look something up. Because I feel like I saw an app that actually, Ava.
Ava can read your lips?
Ava, it was on Product Hunt. It's for hard of hearing people, and I'm trying to think.
Oh, it provides captions. Here, let's watch the video. This is the promotional video for Ava.
I am not very different from anyone else.
I'm a pretty normal girl, I think.
I could be one of the neighbors.
He's got a cochlear implant.
We've run into each other.
So these are obviously.
I like guessing what people say to each other when they are floating.
I like when people make efforts to communicate with me. It really makes my day.
I was about to say, he did the wrong.
I am deaf.
I am hard of hearing, and I'm pretty good at reading lips.
But indistinct chatter, she can't understand it. Can you pass me the gravy? Now she can.
When
she
there's
can
too
read
many
lips.
People, though, this can get really tough.
This is a long video, so we won't
this
go through
is super
the whole
long.
Thing.
I'm
yeah.
Like,
but so Ava shows you what people say in less than a second. Easy communication. But does it read lips?
So that I was like, wait, did I bring this up? I don't think it reads lips. I think it helps understands the sound and does speech recognition.
Huh. I can't tell.
Let's see. My aunt and uncle are deaf, so I'm always
really?
Interested in these. Really?
Wow.
So that's, I'm always
technology.
Okay, so it does life captioning.
Oh, live captioning. Okay.
Well, it says life here, but yeah, I think that's the idea. So it does captions. So it's obviously some sort of speech recognition.
Okay, so not as exciting. But imagine that for
right, and that would get better, and especially in a noisy environment, it would get better because it could also it could also do that. Well, that's very cool.
And you could think about it this way. Ready? Imagine it's on it's part of your doorbell cam, for example. And then you have the ability for someone to come
up. You could see
up
the UPS guy swearing at you.
Exactly. Or, whatever. Some Girl Scout trying to sell you cookies. but just when you start thinking about where you can put, once it's in software, you can put it anywhere. So, I don't know. I get excited.
Ow. Ow. Ow.
I just stubbed my toe. Unfamiliar desk.
Uh-oh.
Oh.
Ow. Tila Tequila was suspended from Twitter for pro-Nazi posts.
So I got this question a lot in Europe. I just got back from Berlin.
Who is Tila Tequila? I even wonder that. Oh, okay.
Yeah, that. What do you do about the requirements to get rid of hate speech for Facebook? Here I am saying.
Well, Germany's done that very effectively, have they not?
Yeah, it's hot again because of the whole fake news thing.
Well, didn't France do this whole thing you couldn't sell Nazi memorabilia on eBay, and that was a pain for a while? That was
Germany.
A big deal.
Germany too. Yeah.
But it goes beyond that now.
Well, yes.
By the way, I went to a museum where they told you could take pictures of everything, but not legally of Nazi memorabilia, of Nazi symbols.
Somebody said that it's unlikely that the Brexit Trump kind of move towards authoritarian populism would happen in Germany because they've been through it already and they're kind of hypersensitive.
So I gave a talk at the Hub conference, which is a 2,000 person big tech conference that's in Berlin. And it just went up online, by the way. And I argued that I said, listen, we're going to be busy for the next 4 years here. Stop defining yourself against America. We need your leadership. We need Europe, in particular Germany, to be a leader, not only politically, but also technologically. That's a controversial thing to say. because it makes them uncomfortable, makes them a little hot on the collar.
Really?
Well,
why?
We don't really want to be leaders because we've been leaders before.
Oh, they're really and, that sensitive to that
oh, yeah,
whole
so
idea.
And so it's a sensitive thing to say.
Interesting.
There was a tweet. Oh, I got to find this. I love this tweet. Wait one second. I'm going to find the tweet. So a guy named Nathaniel Staples, said, quote, "Oh, I get it. In World War III, Germany gets to save the rest of the world from fascists." That's a pretty solid third act.
I saw that. I saw that tweet. I thought that was very funny.
It was very good.
So Merkel is up for a re-election soon,
yeah,
right?
So she just announced that she was going to do it again. Fully tired. And I talked to journalists and liberals who said, "I've never voted for the CDU before, but I'm going to now." Because of
is
the
she running against
stability.
a nationalist candidate?
Well, there's something called the Alternative for Deutschland, the AfD, that's out there. And they could get, some are scared that she would lose. Some are scared that it's going to turn into America, UK, France, and such. So it's kind of the last stable, sane leadership in the Western world, damn near. It's going on, you know, Austria. Hungary,
France is about to
France.
Go for Marie Le Pen. We think
there's roilings around as there are now, and so yeah, it's a big topic of discussion there.
You know, what worries me is after this, I think Kanye might actually win in 2020.
Yeah, I know.
Wow.
Like a Kardashian in the White House.
A Kardashian in the White House. That's about. I mean, really,
it's about where we're headed. Yeah, it is. It is. The other thing in Germany, just mentioned in Germany, was renewed talk. I don't think it'll go that far, but renewed talk of trying to give Snowden asylum. He was called to testify before the legislature, and they kind of demanded to be there. Well, the only way he could be there is if they gave him some conditions. There's talk again. The Greens are going again, but there's at least talk in some circles about trying to figure out what to do about Snowden and his vulnerability in Russia.
Okay.
Did we lose Jeff or did we lose me?
We pushed the wrong button, I think.
Ah.
You can lip read? Are you going to lip read me now?
Hold on. Let me get my Google AI.
Obama was talking with Der Spiegel when he was in Germany. Der Spiegel asked if he was going to pardon Snowden. President Obama said, "I can't pardon him. He hasn't gone before a court and presented himself." That's actually not true.
No, not at all.
Remember that Nixon was pardoned by President Ford. And had not been in front of a court. He goes on to say, it's not something I would comment on at this point. Now, Obama, by the way, is a former law professor. He knows perfectly well what he can and cannot do. So that's dodging the question. "I think Mr. Snowden raised some legitimate concerns. How he did it was something that did not follow the procedures and practices of our intelligence community. If everybody took the approach, I make my own." I don't want to read this. It just makes me angry.
But the acknowledgement that he raised important issues... Has that happened before from Obama?
No, he's come a little bit in the right direction on this.
Maybe it's a trial balloon.
At the point at which Mr. Snowden wants to present himself before the legal authorities and make his arguments or have his lawyers make his arguments, I think those issues come into play. Until that time, what I've tried to suggest both to the American people but also to the world is that we have to balance this issue of privacy and security. Yeah, he's dodging the question, basically.
Yeah, he is. Is and if Snowden, what about
by the way, Obama has already pardoned three Iranian Americans who haven't stood trial, so this is just clearly like I'm not going to answer that question, but
without actually saying I'm not answering the question.
Well, he should. I mean, it's pretty clear. Snooper's charter is now or is about to be law in the UK. This is an extreme surveillance law that Theresa May, the current UK Prime Minister, has been proposing for several years. Now that she's the Prime Minister, she got both houses of Parliament to approve it. It just remains for the sovereign to approve it, and it will be the most extreme surveillance law in Europe. Edward Snowden says it goes farther than many autocracies in a tweet. The list of things that the government can now do and is incredible. And by the way, it requires tech companies to collect and retain materials for use by the government in secret in most cases. It requires back doors. It eliminates encryption in many cases. It's a very bad model for what could happen here.
Oof.
And Madison Square Garden says hackers have spent a year harvesting visitor credit card data. I like how patient hackers have become. For five different events, malware has been capturing payment card data from a system that processes payments. I'm sorry, for five different properties, not five different events. Unauthorized access to the Madison Square Garden payment processing system. And installation of a program that looked for payment card data as it was being routed through the system for authorization. So just a little snooper. Cards used to buy merchandise and food and drinks at these properties from November 9th of last year through October 24th of this year may have been affected. Did you buy a hot dog at Madison? Yeah, kind of like a skimmer, but a software.
Yeah, I sure have.
Have you bought a hot dog at Madison Square Garden, the theater at Madison Square Garden, Radio City Music Hall, Beacon Theater, or Chicago Theater? Good news.
So isn't that data supposed to be encrypted?
Good question.
Okay.
It would be if you used Apple Pay or Android Pay. Maybe not if you used a credit card. Metallica's full catalog is now on Napster. how times have changed. It's not the same. It's the same Metallica. It's not the same Napster. That's the key. Metallica hasn't changed. Napster has. Tesla's deal to merge with SolarCity is a done deal. If you buy SolarCity panels now, you'll be buying them from Tesla Solar. I have SolarCity panels and a Tesla.
Now, do you have a zero electricity bill now?
No, because we did...
you did the lease thing?
Lease purchase option or whatever, purchase option, which is... They own the panel. We didn't pay any money for the installation of the panels or the panels themselves. And we agree to buy back electricity from SolarCity as opposed to from our power company at a guaranteed fixed rate over 20 years of 18 cents per kilowatt hour, which is considerably less than the top rate in California. And we were in tier four a lot of the time. If we use more power than the panels produce, then we'd go back to the utility, but we start at tier one, so it should still save us money. It saved us, I think, a considerable amount of money. And the idea being with nothing up front, the savings is immediate.
Right, right.
So it makes me feel good. That's the main thing.
And if you drive a Tesla, it's nice because you're powering your car.
Yeah. The local power company, PG&E in California, will not let you put panels in that produce more electricity than you're currently consuming. So you can't do it like a profit deal.
there's no like solar mining.
Which they should, right? If somebody wants to generate electricity, let them.
They don't have the proper back and forth yet on the grids, though, to manage that, I guess.
I think it has more to do with the fact that the business of PG&E is building power plants, frankly.
Okay, that too. That's always an issue with these guys.
Yeah. They just have to go kicking and screaming. And, you know, they're kicking and screaming. That's all. Did you see that? Okay, so Samsung is the number one smartphone maker. But did you see that Apple gets 91% of all the smartphone profit worldwide?
That's probably lower now than it used to be. It used to be like 95%.
So it's down?
I think so.
I'm going to right now do something I should have done a long time ago, which is disable the flash autoplay video. Why I've left that on for so long is beyond me. Plugins. Oh, it says that. Let me choose when to run plugin content. Well, I didn't choose that.
Okay, somebody so Apple now has 94% of global smartphone profits back in November 2015.
Ah. Well, so that's the one. But see, it takes a while to get all that information collated.
In July of 2015, it had 92%.
It's going up.
Well, no, that would be... So, no, 94 was a year ago at this time.
Okay, so it's going down a little bit.
So then it went down. So it's going down.
It's still a pretty high number. If 90 cents of every dollar in profit, it's still pretty good.
I'm just giving you a little historical perspective here.
What's interesting is that Samsung, despite the flop that was the Note 7, is still the number one smartphone maker worldwide.
Oh my gosh, you guys. There are two of those downstairs. Still.
What? There are two Note 7s in the house?
Yes.
Tell mom and dad. Is it your parents?
Yeah.
What is their story?
They don't want to get rid of it.
And it hasn't blown up yet, so it probably isn't, right?
And it hasn't blown up yet.
But didn't Samsung like disable charging or something? Or
so the newest thing is they're
you can only charge it to 60%.
You can only charge it. Has that happened to them already?
That's what she told me. Now I don't know how accurate that is.
By the way, what I just said was me echoing what they're probably thinking, but in fact that is not true. That the fact that it hasn't blown up yet means it won't. Because
it's a flaw in the battery.
What we think is the battery is too much battery for the space, and you get electroplating of the lithium over time, and that at some point it joins the layers together electrically and shorts. So it is, in fact, a process that could happen over time. So in other words, just because it hasn't caught on fire doesn't mean it won't.
I explain that.
They understand that.
They understand that.
I don't blame them. What do they love about it?
It's a great phone. It's the best phone of the year.
Great phone, and I think my mom's just stubborn. I love her, but she's stubborn.
I'm not giving up my phone.
Yeah.
I basically love it. I don't blame
her. She didn't talk like that, though, Leo.
Does she? She probably says y'all, doesn't she?
No, she's a Yankee. She's
a Yankee.
From upstate New York.
Oh, my people.
Yeah.
That's where my people are from. I think we've, anything else? Did I miss anything?
Man, I am so low energy. I feel bad. I'm sorry, you guys.
You're great. No, you're always great.
I am too. I'm getting jet lag. It's hitting me, so.
Oh, well, let's all go to bed.
I'm going to chop some sweet potatoes.
Yum. You're not making sweet potato pie. Tell me you're not making sweet potato pie.
No, I'm making a sneakily healthy version of sweet potatoes, but I'm sticking marshmallows on the top for my daughter and my mom.
I love sweet potato
pie. Imagine
if you
had that oven with you for Thanksgiving. Imagine what you could do.
Sweet potato pie.
Gee, I have imagined, Jeff.
What's on the menu?
This one is at my parents' house, so we're doing a very traditional turkey, breadcrumb and sage and celery stuffing and green bean casserole.
That's about what we're doing, except we're doing a ham instead of a turkey because I like to be different.
I like hams.
One year we
did Cornish game hens. That was a weird year.
Yeah, I think that's what Lisa's sister's doing is Cornish game hens. They're too small. I don't.
They're tiny little birds.
Tiny little birds.
She's like, tiny it's difficult.
Google Home is on. This just in: Google Home is on sale. Target.
$99.
Black Friday special, $99.
Oh hell! Okay, I'm gonna pitch Can I pitch it?
This pisses me off.
So actually, I talked to someone on Twitter about this. They asked Google if they could get the promo price, and the answer was no. They went to Best Buy to see if they could get the promo price, and the answer was maybe. So let us know if you get that. But I was going to say, this is shameless, but I'm going to do it because it benefits you guys. We did, for the podcast, the IoT podcast, which is out, we did some Black Friday deals, and like, don't pay more than $40 for an Amazon Echo Dot.
I got the Dot. I paid $50 for the Dot, but I was happy with $50. That's such a cut.
Well, this is for Black Friday. Don't pay more than $200 for like a Nest thermostat. Don't pay more than, I think it's $150 for the Nest Cam. The Ring doorbell, which is a sponsor of the show, is I think $50 off.
Nice.
So there's a lot of good smart home deals running around out there, and the Google Home is $99, so don't pay more than that.
I've noticed that. There's some real cutting going on.
There is. Oh, and if you like the Arlo's, $350 for a pack of four is a Best Buy doorbuster.
What is Arlo's?
Oh, you haven't seen them? They're cute. They're these little outdoor wireless cameras with motion sensing and
battery. It's the Netgear camera. Mm-hmm. Arlo. Are they good?
Yes. So I was really excited about all these battery-powered cameras.
Right.
Until the batteries ran out and I realized that I stuck. Like, one of them I have up in a tree.
Yeah.
So you got to climb back up and get.
See, that's what I like about the Ring, because it has a solar panel.
A solar panel.
Yeah.
So I tried that and it was all right.
What's wrong? Does it not?
Mine did not want to stay connected to the Wi-Fi network very well.
Yeah. Well, you can't put it out on a. You can't put it too far. You know what? You need the Eero so that you can reach the Wi-Fi. Can reach out to the Arlo. Can reach out to the.
Yes.
The stick up.
Yes, that was a challenge, but.
I have ordered the Google Wi-Fi hub, and I got mine.
Someone just did a test and said it was great.
Yeah, you know who did the test? Somebody commissioned by Google.
Oh, well, yeah.
We think it's faster. I'm going to do the test when I get it. And I'm going to put it in the same environment that Eero is. Because as I mentioned, I have two networks and I can put them side by side. And I will give you a test not paid for by Google.
So I've got some really exciting gadgets coming in the Wi-Fi world. So stay tuned.
Can't wait.
Any hints?
I've written about them before. It's a different type of Wi-Fi. It's from Plume.
Yeah.
And they're doing Wi-Fi as a service. So there's these tiny little hexagons you plug in.
I ordered those as well. Are yours coming?
Mm-hmm.
I ordered the Luma and the Plume.
Dude.
And still no word, but I have the Eero, and I will be testing the Google December 9th. Mine Google's come.
So
this is, you know what? I think really these are all of a category, and probably will end up all being roughly the same. I can't imagine there'd be that much of a difference.
Oh, and we didn't talk about Apple getting out of the router business. Here
and
we
Apple,
are talking
in a timely fashion. Throwing up its hands, saying, "Okay, that's it. Apple's getting out of every business except the iPhone, ultimately, right?"
Well, I guess if it's losing the profit share, I mean, it's sucking 3% fewer profits out of the industry.
It's, you know, it really feels like it's backing down on the Mac. They're really moving backwards on the Mac. It makes sense that they should get rid of their monitor business and their AirPort business because those accessories, you know, are duplicated at a lower price by other companies. Apple would have to do a mesh thing. They'd have to spend some energy doing that. So I think that they're really... I think really what's happening is Apple's just narrowing its focus to the products that make it a lot of money. And then, I presume, investing heavily in something that's going to be the next big thing. And my opinion is it's augmented reality. Tim Cook sent a lot of signals. That's where he thinks the next big thing is. Not cars. Not TV. Not watches. All right.
Yeah, Microsoft was showing that off at Hub. There are two interesting things I saw at Hub. One was Microsoft showing off, you know, an elevator repair man going and with AR.
Which makes a lot of sense. That makes a lot of sense.
It does. Like Google Glass. The other thing, by the way, was HP was there showing their 3D printing technology. And they're going to get to the point that 90% of the parts for a 3D printer will be made by the 3D printer.
Wow.
So you just have to make the first one, and the 92nd...
That's really cool.
Isn't it?
It's bootstrapping the printer. I like it.
Yeah.
HP, it's interesting. HP split into two this past year, and HP Enterprise did not do great for the year, although Meg Whitman said they did. It was pretty clear the numbers were rocking it. However, the HP Inc., which is the PC printer division, did very well, considering. So... I thought that was interesting. Now, it's time for your picks of the week. Why don't you start, Stacey?
Okay, well, you mentioned mine. It's and I don't have the physical book because I'm not at home, and it's on my Kindle. I'll just be honest.
So you really don't have the physical book. So show us your phone and say, see, it's on here. Here's the book.
I was like, I can show you all.
No, I have the book. I'll show the book. Just ta-da! There it is. We interviewed Kathy O'Neill on Monday for airing next Monday. Tell us about the book.
Weapons of Math Destruction. And this is a book. So I have been obsessed with how algorithms will shape people's lives in the future. And for a time, actually, I thought about leaving, like years ago, I thought about leaving GigaOm and actually starting a project on my own doing this with a podcast. And I didn't because I was lazy. It was intimidating, whatever. But everything I was trying to do, she actually did. And she's a former quant person at a hedge fund who was looking at how math was influencing people, how algorithms were influencing how people were, you know, given merit pay and served in their community and even like dictating, you know, police presence in their neighborhoods. And she realized that all of these things, you know, they had such influence and no one knew about it. It's kind of like how your credit score can be used in so many different ways that you might be unaware of, right? Back in the day. or these crazy micro-targeted ads. So the book is basically just her journey and talking about that. And it's really eye-opening if you don't think about this already. So I really recommend it to anyone who wants to know more about this.
And lots of really good examples. And her real complaint is that we trust these opaque algorithms because it's math. Yeah. And we're often thought, you know, well, if you don't trust the math, you must be a Luddite. When in fact, she's saying the math is wrong. The algorithms are opaque and so not auditable. And we are basing a lot of policy on these algorithms. And it's actually a real eye-opener. You highly recommend the book. And our interview is Monday on Triangulation with Kathy O'Neill.
I'm going to tune in.
She was very impressive. We did not have enough time. I want to have her back and talk more. She's also started a data journalism program at Columbia. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to spend more time talking about data journalism. I know that's something you talk a lot about, Jeff.
Jeff's eyes, he just went, boop.
Yeah.
Math. Yeah. Data journalism.
No, but that's what this is all about. And data journalism is going to end up being about, I think, exposing some of these algorithms as much as...
I can't find it, too, right now. There was a story that came by a study yesterday that showed how often journalists misuse data.
Yep.
Oh, it has numbers in it, so we think it's okay, and we misinterpret it, and we're not good at numeracy. And I think we're misusing it badly.
Do you make your students read a mathematician reads the newspaper?
I think one of the classes actually. I think the business guy does that. I think that's
interesting.
It's a good book.
It is.
I mean, it's tough, but
Kathy worked on the. I'm sure you'll know this program, the LEAD program on data journalism. It's a joint effort of Columbia's School of Journalism and Department of Computer Science. And it's to give journalists the computational savvy to do this stuff, which is really
I want to take that class. Yeah,
doesn't
want
that sound great?
New York.
I know. Yeah. I know.
I wish someone would do that in UT.
You should. You're a great journalist, Stacey, and you really have that enterprise spirit of digging into a story. And I think
I just don't know math. My stats is terrible.
Yeah.
I failed.
Yeah. She started the LEAD program at Columbia, so this is definitely a book to read. Your number of the week, Mr. Jarvis.
Well, I guess I'll give you two of them. One of them is, we spoke about a 3D printer a minute ago, my friend Bill Gross's 3D printer company, which is What is it called? New Matter. They have a Black Friday sale on. I just saw this in my email come across. I got it for $2.99 because I crowdfunded. Normally $3.99, but it's going back to $2.99 on Black Friday. So you get the Mod T, which is a really cool black little printer. And then the other thing was, have you gotten a $15 check from Facebook?
No. Am I getting one?
Well, you might. It's part of the settlement that Facebook
does. Do I have to give them my actual address?
Ill-fated advertising campaign. So I wonder who, you remember that horrible ad structure that was called, I forget the name of it. Is it in there? Where they had you...
I endorsed Leo stuff. I complained because they were using my image to do ads to my.
Well, you should be getting $15.
Good.
Because if you were used in those ads, then you're supposed to get a $15 settlement.
Very good. $15. Wow.
Yeah.
That might get me a sandwich down the road.
How much is the book? Hold on.
Wait a minute. No, it's more than $15.
No, it's $15.85.
There you go.
Oh, there.
Yeah, close.
Use Facebook's filthy lucre to learn something about big data and how Facebook's abusing
it. The Kindle version is $13.99. So
there you go.
YouTube.
Keep a buck.
There you go. My pick of the week is a long-standing, and I've mentioned it before, a to-do program called AnyDo. A lot of people use it on iOS and Android. But the reason I'm very interested all of a sudden is it suddenly is integrated with Amazon's Echo. I've always... Yes. I've always wanted to be able to manage my to-do list from the Echo, and you could, but it was only the Alexa to-do list and the Alexa shopping list. Well, now that's integrated into AnyDo. It's not even an Alexa task. It's just AnyDo will support it. And so you can now use any of your AnyDo lists with your Amazon Echo and remind yourself to do things. And frankly, that's, to me, the easiest way to do it because it's just I'm right there and I can say it and do it.
You could also actually, using if this and that, send your Echo list to the Evernote.
Yeah.
To Ever. Sorry,
you
to
could
Ever.
in the days when you can do stuff with If This Then That.
Oh, so did I need to correct that, actually, because I found out it's still there. You can actually make your recipes.
You can. Even though they turned them all into applets.
They're called applets now, but you actually can go back. I thought I did that. I'm sorry. So, yes, you can still make your own recipes.
Well, that would be nice.
So, because actually Kevin and I were playing with using the Google Home to control more stuff through If This and That, because there's a Google Personal Assistant channel on If This and That. So you can actually connect it to things that aren't actually connected.
Okay.
To the Home.
Good.
But there is like a 1 second latency.
Good. Well, if you don't want to create an If This Then That script, just use AnyDo. It's free. There is a premium version, but the free version works perfectly well with the Amazon Echo. And I do like being able to say, you know, add forks to my shopping list, or remind me to buy a Christmas present for Elisa to my, you know, my reminders and to-dos. And that's very useful. That's very useful. Ladies and gentlemen, the end of the show is nigh. But we thank you all for being here. Thanks to Stacey Higginbotham. You'll find her at stacyonIoT.com and IoTpodcast.com. Get the newest IoT podcast with Kevin Toefel for your Black Friday IoT deals. Have a wonderful Woo-hoo. Thanksgiving in Houston.
Oh, I will.
Yay. In her childhood bedroom. Isn't that sweet? Jeff Jarvis is a professor of journalism at the City University of New York, the author of many a wonderful tome, including Geeks Bearing Gifts, Reinventing the News Biz, and of course he blogs regularly at Buzz Machine and Medium. Oh, I was going to mention one other thing. It's reminding me about Medium. Is Telegram has created a Medium-like kind of posting system called Telegraph, telegraph.ph. And all you have to do is go to telegraph.ph and start writing, and you can publish it on Telegram or Facebook or whatever, and it's like instant articles. It pops up right away, which is really cool. And you can embed photos in here. You can, it's weird because you just get a URL. You can use Markdown. Shall I put a photo in? Let me put a photo in. Do I have one? There we go. That's a good one. And then and then publish it. And now I'm going to have a dedicated URL right here that I can post. And it loads instantly in Telegram, the messenger,
wow.
and a whole bunch of other things. It's an instant messaging. It's kind of like, whatever that thing that Google did that I hated so much. How's that doing, by the way? Is that taking the world by storm?
Yeah. Well.
Which Google thing is this?
You know, ARP. What's it called? Jazz?
Oh, no, Gym? AMP.
AMP?
AMP?
I blocked it out. T-E-L-E. That was actually going to be my pick, but I'll give you two. Telegraph. TELEGRA.PH. Happy Thanksgiving.
Two picks from Leo.
We do the show every Wednesday, 1:30 p.m. Pacific, 4:30 p.m. Eastern. I think I've been getting the UTC times wrong. I think it's -8. So if it's 4:30 Eastern, which is 16:30 -8.
You were saying about math?
Is that 24:30? Huh? Oh, 1:30 Pacific -8 would be 9:30 or 21:30. Yeah, 21:30 UTC. That's what I've been saying. So I guess I'm right. I take it back. I do know mathematics. Time is hard. Join us live if you can in the chat room at irc.twit.tv. If you can't, on demand audio and video is always available at our website, twit.tv/twig. Or wherever you subscribe to your favorite shows. Thank you, everyone, for being here. We appreciate it. And we will see you next time on This Week in Google. Have a great Thanksgiving for those of you in the U.S.